What unique nutritional needs do women have? Why am I hungry shortly after eating a meal? How can I curb junk food cravings? All that and more on this episode of The Healthiest You. As women, we're always balancing a lot on our plates. But how about what's actually on our meal plate? Finding the right foods to fuel our body without depriving ourselves of the occasional treat doesn't have to be as complicated as diet culture tells us it is. We are focusing on women's health and wellness on the Healthiest You podcast. Whether you're on your way to work or enjoying a cup of coffee, take this time to focus on your health. Here to talk about simplifying nutrition and weight management for women is Cheryl Jesuit Rutkauskas, registered dietitian with LVPG Bariatric Medicine, and Dr. Angela Magdaleno with LVPG Bariatric Medicine and LVPG Endocrinology. Cheryl and Dr. Magdaleno, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
What we eat can really make a difference in how we feel each day. So let's start off by talking about what women need to nourish their bodies and really feel their best. So do women have specific nutritional needs? And if so, what are they?
Everyone has specific nutritional needs. Women aren't any different, depending on their life cycle and where they're at.
Sure.
They could need more or, you know, of certain nutrients, especially during, you know, adolescence and then during, you know, pregnancy, lactation. And our needs will change based on our life cycle.
Folate is really important, right? If you're preparing for...
If you're preparing for having a child, okay. Yes. If you're preparing for a baby, yes. Uh-huh. You want to get a prenatal vitamin that'll have enough folic acid to prevent deficiencies.
And vitamin D, most people, mm-hmm. that's not unique to women. Most people are deficient in vitamin D.
Yes, I am that. Yes. Yep, I've had this conversation with my doctor. Vitamin D and vitamin B12 are my things that mm-hmm. I try to take every day. Doesn't always happen.
And vitamin D is a vitamin that gets stored in fat. So you do want to be careful. You can overdo vitamin D. But like we said, I mean, it's individualized, but most people are deficient. But check with your doctor. You can get your level checked. B12, for most people, if you're eating meat, usually you're getting enough, but you can take a multivitamin as kind of a catch-all. And then iron, if you're eating meat, usually you're getting enough, but depending on how heavy your cycles are, you know, you could be low. But like Cheryl was saying, depending on the phase of life you're in, if you're trying to get pregnant, if you are pregnant, right. having a baby, growing a baby does take from your nutrient supply. Mm-hmm. So it's just an even more important time to focus on whole real foods, getting the right nutrients, nothing super special, kind of a lot of what we say on the day-to-day, but really prioritizing it even more in that phase of life.
Well, that's really great. A lot of helpful information. Thank you. So now I know I can't eat pizza or breadsticks like I used to when I was in college. My metabolism is clearly a lot different. Times have changed. And I really notice when I'm starting to indulge a bit too much, I see a difference on the scale. So can we talk about how nutritional needs change over the course of a woman's life and her metabolism as well?
That's a good question. I think you could. I think you have a great answer for this one.
So yes, I mean, I think in our department, our bariatric medicine department, this is the biggest sort of complaint or concern that we get from our patients is things have changed. What used to work, what I used to eat, I'm seeing has a different impact on my body. So we do know as we age, especially as females, it's not that our metabolism is changing rapidly.
Okay.
It's just that due to our life cycle changes, due to our muscle mass that we tend to lose after a certain age and we can get weaker and weaker, our body tends to be better at storing body fat. So we do start to see some of the foods that we choose to eat, pizza, breadsticks, snack foods, crackers, chips, pretzels, the things that we like to indulge on, salty, crunchy foods, they tend to be very calorically dense. Mm-hmm. And we tend to store them more, especially with lower muscle mass and maybe not moving as much. Also, as we get older, I think we forget about that. You know, a lot of times we focus only on the diet and go, well, wait a second. When I was in college, was I walking 5 miles a day to classes?
Yeah.
Was I also exercising at the gym because I just had more time? And
that's
now that I'm
point.
Working 8 hours a day and I have a family,
it's so much harder.
I'm not moving
as
much.
Yeah.
And you know, and that really I think has more of an impact on lower muscle mass and metabolic rate over time.
Yeah, see, when I was in college, I used to dance all the time and I have a minor in dance. So that was something. I was at the dance studio all the time and I could eat those little pizzas that you just threw in the oven, those cheesy breadsticks, all of that yummy stuff. And now as an adult, like it's so hard finding that balance between work and family, keeping the house clean. And it's just not the same. If only it got a little easier as we got older, but it just gets a little more complicated when it comes to food. So,
another thing, what the studies show is that after age 30, every 5 years, women lose a significant amount of muscle and it just continues to decline. And that starts at age 30. Mm-hmm. So you can counterbalance that by strength training and of course, adding in movement. But like you just said, you know, with time constraints, it's challenging.
It is.
But we are losing that muscle mass. We are having the desk jobs. We're less active. And so all of that kind of compounds where it gets harder to eat as much of those fun foods.
It does. I've really noticed it now. What other nutrient deficiencies are women prone to having?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I would definitely recommend everyone sees their own doctor and gets their own kind of assessment of symptoms and maybe blood work to see if anything's needed. Mm-hmm. As we mentioned, kind of the general population is vitamin D deficient. Another common one could be iron for women, especially if they have heavy menses. And then if you're vegetarian, it could be iron or B12 could be common if you're vegetarian or vegan.
Okay.
My general recommendation to my patients would be a multivitamin. Plus folic acid, if you're in the prenatal range, and maybe biotin. But a multivitamin is a good catch-all. If you had a little extra pizza and didn't maybe get your whole real foods or you skipped your veggies one day, the multivitamin should be able to kind of give you that catch-all without really overdoing anything.
Okay. Now I'm curious, cause this is something I struggle with all the time. I always have ice cold hands and feet. Is that possibly a sign of like an iron deficiency?
It could be. It could also just be your circulation. It could be genetic. It could be environmental. Maybe you're in a cold room.
I'm always cold.
Yeah. And there's certainly other conditions. So I would definitely recommend talking to your family doctor about it because there are other conditions that could be related to that. But some people just run cold. I tend to have cold hands too. But that's, I think, where the saying comes, cold hands, warm heart.
I love that. That's so cute because every time I go to hold my husband's hand, he's like, oh my goodness, your hands are so cool.
And that's how I tell my husband he's there to warm them up for me. That's his job then. Yep.
I love that. And what do you think, Cheryl, about supplements and vitamins?
So I definitely agree with Dr. Magdaleno. I think most of my patients, I do recommend a one a day, especially for like a female. For somebody over 50, they might not need the extra iron if they have stopped their menses with menopause. Mm. So then I would say of women over 50. But I also think it's important to look at what you are eating. And if you are not getting certain nutrients from your food, those are the ones that are most likely we would want to supplement. So some patients of mine who don't get a lot of like omega fatty acids in fish or nuts or seeds because they have food dislikes, then I might recommend an additional supplement to kind of, you know, cross that, you know, bridge or meet that need.
Well, I love salmon. I love scallops. So that's good. And I love taking my vitamins. Yeah. I tried to. Yeah. So, and I'm a huge foodie. So, which brings me to my next question. So eating a good meal with my husband, trying a new restaurant, it's totally my thing. I love that. It brings me a lot of joy. So can you kind of walk me through what a day of healthy eating looks like for a woman where we can still go out to eat, still enjoy a meal, but also still be mindful that I got to get my nutrients in or I'm not going to feel my best?
Yeah, I mean, I think we like a balanced approach. And I, of course, like to dine out. And,
yes,
you know,
who doesn't?
We're fun too. We like fun.
Try the newest thing. But I think, you know, when it comes to the quality of your diet, I think you want to make sure that you're hitting, you know, certain things. And I think, you know, first of all, eating a little bit more structured meals. I think, you know, definitely getting 3 meals in a day.
Okay.
Snack as needed. But the quality of the meal is important. So, you know, not grabbing something on the way to work and not thinking about it, the convenience type food. But we know that, you know, and the research does support that starting your day off with at least 30 grams of protein can really help balance your hunger and appetite and satiety longer throughout the day as well.
Oh, I love that you just said that because we're going to talk about the 30-30-30 weight loss trend, which is that whole concept of having the 30 grams of protein within 30 minutes of waking. So, I'm excited.
But I think going off what Cheryl said is balance, right? So you can live your life and go out. You can do it all.
Okay.
And if you're going out, choose something with protein. Have some vegetables to start your meal rather than an appetizer. Maybe choose an appetizer or dessert. Maybe share the dessert and portion control, right? When we go out, there's usually added oils. There's usually added grease. There's usually bigger portions. It doesn't mean you can't have it, but maybe pick one thing or portion control it, take them home, and really set the rest of your day up for success. So having protein and vegetables at every meal is really what I try to do, protein, vegetables, and fiber. That fiber really makes you feel full and satisfied too. And it feeds your gut microbiome, which is also a huge topic and really important too. So I'm also known as, I give my kids vegetables, like green beans with breakfast.
Yeah.
And my kids think it makes sense. Cucumbers with breakfast.
Like, that's a really good
idea. You say that to people and they think you're crazy. My kids think it's normal. And they also get treats. Like, don't come at me. But it's good. They eat their green beans with their eggs, with their, you know, it's a balanced meal. And that's how it should be. In America, we tend to go for the sugary cereals, the sugary yogurt, the waffles, the donuts. If it's not sugar and carbs, we're not happy. But that's not how it's supposed to be.
It's ridiculous how much sugar is in things. Mm-hmm. It's bad. Mm-hmm. It's no wonder we're, you know, sugar happy, really. Mm-hmm.
Or hangry. That's hangry. Where the hanger comes from.
Oh my goodness.
It's the sugar crash.
My
that's
husband
where the
knows
hanger.
When that's happening.
And that's the opposite of what protein and fiber does, right? Protein and fiber really helps to balance hunger, maintain satiety longer. So you don't have that dramatic, you know, sensation of feeling full like sugar and high carb starch meals do. And then boom, dropping and needing more, sugar or caffeine or something else. So I think kind of having that game plan, even before you dine out and say, okay, I'm not eating all day because I'm dining out at this great place. You know, that's not always going to be the most fulfilling thing is to kind of plan ahead and get the protein fiber meals in beforehand. So then you can enjoy a nice relaxed meal.
I love that. And that's something that we tend to do, especially when we go to the diner, because we're big diner people. And we'll usually get like the pulled pork meal with the side of the fried eggplants. And we'll go home and we have like a meal for the next day. Yes. It's great. And then we don't have to cook. Right. Although I don't really do a whole lot of cooking. My husband cooks most of the time.
That's nice though.
And I love that, you know, you're incorporating green beans in with your children's breakfast in the morning, because I thought I was just the weird one, but I love like actual meatloaf or things that you would eat for dinner at breakfast time, because I find if I don't eat something that really, you know, is going to sustain me throughout my morning, I'm so hungry by 10 o'clock and then I have to eat again.
And you don't want to spend all day thinking about food. Yes. You don't want to be obsessing about food. You really want to eat a satisfying meal with protein, fiber, vegetables that fills you up so you can go about your day, so that you can use your brain, so that you can have the energy. It's when we start our day with the sugar roller coaster where we get a glucose spike and then a glucose crash that leaves us hungry, leaves us craving, leaves us thinking about the next meal or caffeine or dragging. And that's where we start feeling not our best. So really setting yourself up for success with protein and vegetables is the way
to do it. I love it. So what are macronutrients and their purpose?
So there are three different macronutrients that provide energy to our body, which is the form of calories, which we know that word. There's carbohydrates, protein, and fat. So carbohydrates are the main source of energy for our cells. So we eat things that are high in carbohydrates. They get broken down into sugar and into the cell for energy.
Okay.
We have then protein, which is one of the most important nutrients. It is the building block of all of our cells, our muscle mass. So we want to make sure we get that every day. And then there's our fats, and our healthy fats are important to have every single day. It's another strong macronutrient. It really helps with muscle movement. It helps to cushion our organs, which no one talks about, but we need that little bit of fat
important.
In our body. Yeah. And they're all responsible for our mechanisms in our body to make our body run and function well.
Let's talk about protein first. So we know that there's animal-based protein, there's plant-based protein, a lot of different options, even powders. So can you talk a bit about what quality proteins you would recommend?
So I recommend all the quality, all proteins. So animal-based proteins, plant-based proteins, and protein powders. We can go through all three. Animal-based proteins are the most complete protein, meaning they have all of the amino acids that our body needs. And so we recommend them. They're from eggs and chicken and fish, beef, pork, dairy products as well. And so, you know, when we look at animal products, the thing we might recommend is, you know, choosing ones that are a little bit leaner.
Like
you would do the chicken breast versus the chicken thigh, or just removing the fat from the actual piece of meat before you prepare it. Because there is that nice healthy marbling of the fat in the meat that we would need, but we don't necessarily need the excess outside, of the protein. Now, plant-based proteins are excellent. They don't have as much protein as animal source. So they have a little bit less. So you have to really pay attention and make sure you're getting enough of it. If you're choosing beans and legumes, quinoa has a good amount of protein, soy-based proteins. So you want to make sure that you're hitting, you know, enough for the day. So the more concentrated proteins would be from animal products.
Okay. Now, how about venison? Because
venison's fantastic. It's a really lean protein. And it's very, very high quality. It's gamey a little bit, but it's grass-fed natural protein. Sometimes you can get very easily in the wild,
yes,
right?
So, I know how. Yep.
So yeah, we recommend that. Some of those sort of, you know, gamier meats, you just have to know how to prepare them. I think a lot of people don't know how to necessarily tenderize them in a way that makes them a little bit more easily to consume. Yes,
my mom is really good at making venison.
Good.
Now, how much protein should women be getting each day?
So the amount of protein that a person needs is actually based on ideal body weight.
Okay.
I would recommend, I think we agree, that a minimum of 65 grams per day would be the goal, which the studies really show that getting about at least 20 grams of protein per meal is when we turn off hunger hormones.
I have those.
me too.
So bad.
So to feel full and satisfied, if you're aiming for at least 20 grams of protein per meal, three meals a day, maybe one snack, you're getting about 65 grams.
One snack?
Are you snacking a lot?
Yes, I am.
But are you getting your 20 grams per meal?
I try. It doesn't always happen. Sometimes if I'm in a rush. Probably why that hunger hormone doesn't stop talking.
Exactly. So if you upped your protein and your fiber at each meal and you would feel more satisfied, you should be able to go 4 hours between each meal. When we get too much snacking, that's when we end up on the blood sugar roller coaster. That's when we're spiking our insulin a little more often. That's when our body's constantly digesting food. It's not getting time to rest and recover and work on other functions. So really, I recommend trying to stick to three meals a day.
Okay.
If you're truly hungry, have a snack. And maybe the next day, try to eat a little more at those meals of protein and fiber to reduce the need for snacking.
I have some work to do. Everyone, my family knows, my colleagues know, Amanda loves her snacks. She has a snack drawer. She's got snack jars. So I got to work on
that. What kind of snacks are you eating?
I like to have an apple with peanut butter.
Good.
I'm really into cashews right now. Yeah. Also, because I'm doing a fast right now, I'm big into eating dates with peanut butter. Things like that. But I do like, you know, a bag of chips here and there.
Yeah, no. And those snacks are complex snacks. There's some fiber, some protein. Mm-hmm. The nuts, they're a little higher in fat, a little less in the protein, but they are complex. And you're pairing your carbs with healthy fats. So that's good.
All right. Thank you. You're making me feel better. Progress. Now, what about protein powders? Like I said, I've bought so many different types of protein powder, plant protein, whey protein. I tried whey protein for a little bit and I felt like it was a little too harsh on my stomach. So I went back to plant protein, specifically like pea protein. Is protein powder like an essential part of your diet? Is it something helpful?
Absolutely not essential, right?
Okay.
So if you're getting enough protein, eating meat and eggs and yogurt and cottage cheese and legumes and nuts, and you're getting your protein, that's the best. I mean, whole, real, unprocessed foods, getting the protein in, that's awesome. Protein powders are a convenience product, right? They're highly processed, but they are a healthier kind of convenient way to get protein in if it's needed. So I use them sometimes. I definitely think that they're for certain people who need to get that protein in. And I definitely will recommend them to patients. But are they essential? No. And if you can eat real food, I think that's better.
Okay, good. Because sometimes I get tired of using the shaker cup.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned cottage cheese. So that's something I enjoy, especially I tend to put like everything bagel seasoning on.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll put it on toast. But it made me think of that viral cottage cheese trend where they you blend it up, you put some cacao powder in and make like a mousse. Have you done that?
Yeah.
Is it good?
It was okay.
Because like they make it look so good. Mm-hmm. And I attempted to try it and it didn't go very well. Like I ended up leaving it in the freezer and it's just kind of hard as a rock. It wasn't really good.
Yeah. Sometimes if you get the craving, you should just have the chocolate.
It just doesn't hit the same as ice cream.
So what I did do with cottage cheese that was fun was I blended it and it kind of became a liquid cheese sauce. Mm-hmm. I added like a little Parmesan, a little milk, little spices, and I put that over some bonza protein pasta and I made my own healthier Alfredo.
I love the bonza protein pasta.
So that was really good because you were keeping the cottage cheese in its own category of kind of like a cheesy sauce.
Okay. Yes.
When you branch out and to use it to desserts, it's kind of like maybe just have a small piece of chocolate and move on.
I agree.
Yeah.
So it tastes how it should.
Yeah, chocolate. Exactly.
How does adequate protein intake impact hormonal health in women?
So when it comes to hunger and fullness, protein is what helps turn off hunger and fullness. So we have true hunger cues and fullness cues in our body. Mm-hmm. And hunger comes on ravenously, as we all know. In order to turn off hunger, we actually have a protein signal that can get sent to the brain. So eating enough protein. The other thing that turns off hunger is the stretch of our stomach. So eating enough volume, eating enough fiber, right? Okay. We all want to feel physically full.
Yes.
And we do that by eating enough protein as well as the stretch of the stomach. So starting your meal with some vegetables, eating a salad starter, really expanding the volume without necessarily expanding the calories or the density. So that's why being careful of processed foods are very calorie dense and you don't stretch your stomach, right? A protein bar these days can be 150 up to 350 calories, but you're not stretching your stomach. You're not feeling physically satisfied. So really trying to turn off hunger and fullness hormones by eating enough protein. Protein really helps balance those.
That's a really good point as far as that volume eating.
Yeah.
I think that's something helpful, especially with our mind when, you know, we're looking at food because like you said, the little protein bar, not much to it. But if you have like a nice big plate of salad with like leafy greens and red beets, it helps.
It kind of goes back to the saying too, like eat with your eyes, right? So our eyes, our brain, it's very smart. Like we're animals, we're trained. We want to see colors. We want to see textures. We want to feel textures. We want to see the different shapes. We want a large volume of food. So you want to eat the rainbow. You want to have a lot of vegetables. You want less calorie dense food and more whole real foods to really feel satisfied.
Have you ever had a poke bowl?
I have.
Yes.
Okay. Me too. I love them. And I think that goes back to that volume eating because there's so much in that. There's edamame, there's salmon, all the things. And I really...
Yeah, absolutely. Even like a burrito bowl, right? If you get like the lettuce on the bottom and then throw the stuff on top, it looks bigger.
Yes. And it's good for the mind because you're like, oh, I'm actually eating a lot more food and I'm going to feel fuller.
And even thinking about how some people use protein shakes, right, as like a meal replacement or a quick, easy breakfast on the go. And I recommend to patients, some patients use those, absolutely. Some people really don't feel full unless they're chewing. So there is another nature kind of hormone, kind of the body anticipating that we should be chewing. So drinking liquid calories, I really don't recommend drinking liquid calories. This is separate from, I do recommend protein shakes, but maybe you munch on a cucumber with it or, you know, have something with it to chew. But drinking liquid calories, so soda, juice, it doesn't turn off hunger, doesn't make you feel full and satisfied. It's kind of empty liquid calories, gives you that sugar roller coaster. So really trying to stick to water and coffee. Coffee's good. Water and coffee. Watch what you're putting in the coffee. And then protein shakes, but depending on the type of person you are. So I like the flavor of protein shakes. Sometimes I really need to chew with my food though.
And I think it's really important to know what, you know, really makes you feel full. A lot of people need the volume. Some people don't. You know, I have patients who I say, you know, maybe try to eat the protein first since it's the most, you know, calorically dense food. So it kind of holds you a little bit and then get the volume of the vegetables to kind of fill up the space. So, you know, really kind of playing around with how you eat, not necessarily what is on your plate, could really impact how satisfied you feel when you, you know, when you have an hour or two later.
And that's a great tip and trick we use with a lot of patients. So even if you're thinking just a balanced plate, half the plate should be non-starchy vegetables, a quarter of the plate is protein, and the other quarter should be complex carbs. You should try to eat your protein and your vegetables first. That's getting into your
protein
stomach.
Protein and veggies first.
It gets in. It's being digested. It's stretching your stomach. It's sending the signal to your brain. I have protein. I'm starting to feel full. And then by the time you're chewing and chewing and you get to that complex carb, you're starting to feel a little more full anyway.
Okay.
And then sometimes you are actually full enough that you slow down a little bit and actually enjoy it. So sometimes if we're still fast working on that. Eating, right? If we're fast eaters, we have a tendency to just eat really quickly and not really taste and don't really have a really clear indication of when we feel full. Mm-hmm. So by trying to eat the protein and vegetables first, you're given that, you know, fullness receptor to be felt and saying, okay, so now I have my little starch. I'm going to enjoy this. And since it's mostly for us, one of our favorite things to eat, then you're actually tasting it.
And not missing out on the good flavor, too, because that's really what it's about.
Exactly.
That's really interesting, though. I didn't know that for some people, and maybe that's part of my problem. I guess I'm not alone in this. You know, I do like protein shakes, and I've been doing them a lot lately. And that's kind of what my breakfast consists of. So maybe I do need to chew on a cucumber or something else because perhaps that's something.
Yeah, maybe you just want to chew or have some of that volume, get the fiber in, get the veggies in. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I've been known to just walk around with carrots or a whole bell pepper and eat the whole, you can just chew it,
a
eat it.
A whole bell pepper during our meeting.
Oh my gosh. It's basically it's an apple. It's
I don't have time to cut it. I'm a busy working mom. Yeah. So you just wash it and I eat it. Grab some carrots, right? Don't judge me.
She does, though.
You can do it with a cucumber. You can do it with a tomato. It keeps the doctor away.
Yeah.
But it really is, you know, you got to get your veggies in. Yeah. You got to get your fiber. I'm eating the rainbow. I don't have time to cut it. Uh-huh. My kids get it cut. Don't worry.
Hey, you know what? As long as the kids have cut peppers and mom's got a pepper, you know, everyone's happy.
We're all okay.
Right. That's so cute. All right. Let's talk about a crowd favorite, the macronutrient carbs. So what are the healthiest carbs to include in your diet?
Well, the complex carbs. So we have the simple carbohydrates and the complex. The complex carbohydrates are the ones that have fiber, which we've been talking about. So those are like the whole grains. A complex carb should have roughly around 3 grams of fiber for those of you who look at food labels. You're not going to feel a lot of satiety if it doesn't have at least 3 grams of fiber per serving.
Okay,
the
3 grams.
The better. So I like to see, you know, 6, 7, 8, sometimes 10 grams of fiber per serving, then you really know that that fullness factor is going to really be in play there. But you'll notice white crackers, chips, pretzels, those have less than 3 grams, sometimes less than 1 gram of fiber. They're not filling food. So those would be classified more as your simple carbs, things that are broken down super easy in the in our stomach and into our bloodstream really quickly, not really giving us the benefit of eating what we call a natural carb.
Okay. What about sourdough bread? I'm really curious because I've gotten into feeding sourdough. So my husband got me the sourdough starter kit and it's been a lot of fun. It's like a nice little activity. I feel like I'm in my bread making era right now. And I feel like a lot of people are.
And I have not yet, but I'm hearing a ton about
it. It is so much fun. It's so satisfying to take something. So it's this dehydrated powder basically. And then you put it in and you fill it up with some water and some flour and you watch it grow throughout the week. And we've made bagels so far. We've made sourdough loaves. I mean, we're very amateur.
That sounds great. I wish you brought some. Yeah.
But I'm curious because I've heard things that it's better for your gut eating sourdough bread. Plus, there's not as many preservatives. There's not all those bad ingredients that you would get typically at a grocery store. So I guess maybe I'm just looking for an excuse to eat more bread. But curious what you think.
I think so. My response would be everything in balance. Mm-hmm. It's still bread, right?
Right.
But I did hear a quote somewhere and it said, if you're going to eat something, if you make it at home, it's 1,000 times better. So just the fact that you're making it at home, it's already better for you. It's still bread, right? It's still not going to be protein dense and everything.
Sure.
But yeah, it's way better for you that you made it, that you know how fresh it is, that you put the ingredients in and the love in, right? And if you go to the time to make it, I think anything you want to eat, if you're going to make it at home, that's better, right? You want a donut? Instead of going through the drive-thru, make it at home.
I have a donut maker too.
If you're going to make it at home, it's already better. It's already better just the fact that you put the ingredients in. So I'm a big proponent of if you want a treat, if you want something special, make it at home, put the love and effort in and then enjoy it.
So as far as carbs, about how much is okay for women?
So I would say that's really individualized.
Okay.
So that is something we do in our practice. We talk to a patient, assess their activities levels, what they've been eating, and we will give certain kind of macronutrient carb recommendations. But for just generalizing, I don't think there's a specific carb ratio because it is individualized. You know, someone who runs every day and is very active and in their 20s or 30s versus someone who's older and isn't as active, you know, it would change. So I think kind of just focusing on more complex, whole, real, unprocessed foods, adding that fiber in, eating the rainbow, that's kind of a better way to think of it than a specific number.
Sure. Eating the rainbow. I love that. That's a good thing to think about. Because it's so satisfying too when you have like a beautiful meal and you see all these different colors. Like going back to the poke bowls, like I love adding the mango and the salsa and just all of the things. It just tastes so good. It looks good. So,
and even again, to normalize it, I mean, we joked about it, but I'm a busy working mom. Yeah. I don't have time to chop and prep 14 vegetables to eat the rainbow at lunch. And I don't get an hour to enjoy my lunch, right? I'm in a meeting munching on a red pepper and a cucumber and telling them what to do. And so, you kind of roll with the punches. Yeah. And I think eating the rainbow doesn't always mean this picture perfect salad that you got to sit and enjoy for an hour.
Right.
I think we should all try to be mindful
it's
while eating.
It's great when it happens.
It's great when it happens.
Realistically, it doesn't.
But realistically, I'm running around with a whole pepper, and that's okay too. So I think, you know, making that okay.
I love it.
You can still get the colors in.
Now, we know the importance of fibers, you know, to keep things moving and grooving. How much fiber should women be getting each day?
So women need at least 25 grams of fiber per day. And so you want to make sure you're getting that from whole foods, which come from your fruits, your vegetables, your whole grains. You can get some from seeds. You can get some from a little bit of the nuts, have a little bit of fiber, any plant-based food.
Okay. What kind of seeds would you?
Any seeds that you like to
chia
eat.
Seeds. Yes.
Sunflower seeds, chia
seeds. Have you ever done chia seeds?
Yes, I've done the chia seed pudding.
That's what I've been eating for breakfast a lot.
I always like to tell my patients too, a chia seed is beautiful because it really shows you what fiber does in the gut. So if you put a chia seed into any fluid, what does it do? It kind of just
soaks it all up like a sponge. Yeah.
Right. And so that's what's really kind of that impactful thing of, oh, why do I feel fuller when I eat this food? It's really taking up the volume in the space. We know that fiber is really beneficial for our gut and our gut microbiome. We see more and more research that supports that we're not getting enough. And I think, you know, when we have patients look at their nutrition plan, fiber is really, protein might be low, but fiber is hard to come by. And we think we're getting enough, but really when we look at it, we're not meeting those recommendations. And those recommendations of over 25 grams of fiber per day have not changed in decades.
Interesting.
We're just not meeting them. And I think
that's a pretty low bare minimum.
And most people don't hit it.
And that's probably why we're feeling kind of, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because there's a difference if you're not, you know, going to the bathroom.
Yeah.
And the gut microbiome, the gut brain connection, there's a lot more data about it. Mm-hmm. And feeding the gut microbiome is really important.
It's really important.
But chia seeds are great.
Good. I have a little jar of chia seeds in my fridge. Good. So
they're
great. Keep using them.
Yeah.
Now, which dietary fats are okay and which ones should be avoided?
So there are saturated fats and unsaturated fats. Saturated fats are found in animal products mainly. Like your whole fat dairy products, your meats, as well as some plants such as coconut and palm. So they're actually they're solid at room temperature, which is kind of a give for that what that saturated fat looks like.
Okay.
More commonly, you'd see unsaturated fats as an oil. They're plant-based.
Yes.
And they're either mono or polyunsaturated fats. And that's based on their omega fatty acid distribution. So how many omega-3s versus omega-6 fatty acids they would have.
Okay. Now, how about some healthy fats?
So unsaturated fats are probably the main source of fats in our diet, I would say, that we should be getting.
Okay.
And they can be from whole foods like avocados, nuts, seeds, or our plant-based oils. Olive oil is a popular one that we recommend a lot.
That's what I cook with.
Avocado oil is becoming more and more popular as well. So those are where we would recommend getting a lot of that. And, you know, you can't forget about some of our oily fish that give us a lot of omega fatty acids. So, you know, the salmon, things like that. So you want to kind of have a wide distribution of fats than anything in your diet. You don't, you know, we talked about having the rainbow of fiber. We want to have the rainbow of fat, I guess, in a way.
That's very true.
That you're getting a good amount of both omega-3s and omega-6 fatty acids. They work the best. Yeah. Not trans fats. Trans fats should not be consumed. They should be out of most of our packaged foods at this point. That was a recommendation. They were supposed to act as a saturated fat. However, they've actually done more damage in our body than natural saturated fats. So they should be eliminated.
And then I would like to say about fats, you know, I think starting kind of in the 1990s, there was this fear of fat developed, kind of that fat makes us fat. And that's when the kind of the low sugar or low fat craze came in and they started taking the fats out of food.
Mm-hmm.
And when they took out the fat to add flavor, they would add sugar. So I always think of is like peanut butter. Peanuts are healthy. They have healthy fat. But when you look at a jar of peanut butter, if you get the low fat option, they're taking out fat and they're pouring in sugar. Mm-hmm. And so sugar is really the problem. problem with processed food and the blood sugar roller coaster and insulin resistance and diabetes. So really, you know, we don't need to fear fat. I think adding in healthy, natural fats, eating the salmon, eating the nuts, adding the olive oil, that we don't need to fear fat. I work with my patients a lot on that. I think there's a lot of fear around fat.
I agree. I mean, even myself, that's a good point. We don't need to fear the fat. We embrace the right kinds of fat.
And fat helps with satiety. It helps you feel fuller longer. It helps with that sensation in our body. And it's also really important to make hormones in our body. Like we need fat. So don't fear fat. You need it. And it makes you feel fuller longer.
That brings me to my next question. How do fats impact female hormones?
So they're part of the building process to make the hormones. So if a woman is not getting enough fat, if she keeps her diet so low fat, then she'll actually have trouble making female hormones or any hormones. They're part of the building blocks.
Hmm. I've never been someone to count calories or macros, but I'm realizing with age, I really have to be more proactive when it comes to health and to fitness. It's not like when I was in college, you know, I'm working 8 hours a day. I'm at a desk typically. So I'm not getting that physical fitness, which leads me to wonder, do I need to start counting macros? Do I need to start doing something a little more in depth to maintain a healthy weight?
So yeah, I think, you know, the old adage of, you know, counting calories has kind of, it still has an importance, you know, to make sure you are eating enough. And for those who are interested in weight loss, that they're slightly, you know, getting a little bit less than what they need. But what we found in the current research is that where those calories come from are the most important thing.
Okay.
And so going back to what we've been talking about, you know, making sure you're hitting a protein goal of at least 65 grams a day or more.
So aim for that protein.
At least, yeah. And that can be higher. I mean, I have my patients consuming much more if I know that they're, you know, more into fitness and if they're strength training and if they're trying to build muscle. And I think it's important to say, you know, what are your goals? I mean, 65 grams of protein for a female is kind of, I call, a basement level in that, you know, that's going to be good for good health. But if you're looking to actually build muscle, research supports that females need a lot more to be able to kind of build on that.
So like 120?
So it depends, right? Okay. It depends on how tall you are, what your current weight is, what's your current fitness level.
I'm pretty short.
So unfortunately, there's no adage of this is what you should, you know, be consuming. But that's where you would come to see a professional like us and kind of saying, okay, this is what my day-to-day looks like. These are my goals, my health goals, my fitness goals. How much should I be getting? And I think if you're going to be tracking what you're eating, the protein is going to be key. The fiber is going to be key as well. And then, like we said, where those carb levels lie. I think if you have metabolic disease where you have to watch your carb levels, maybe somebody who has insulin resistance, metabolic syndrome, PCOS, that might be something we would take a stronger look at the carb level. For a general healthy female, I think looking at her activity level would be the thing that we would kind of, you know, focus on more.
Yeah, there's so many factors that can influence a lot of things.
And I think thinking about where your food's coming from, like we said, it's really hard to overeat salad. Right? This goes back to volume food. If you're really eating your fruits and your vegetables and getting the fiber in and getting those real whole foods, it's really easy to overeat protein bars, protein shakes, McDonald's.
Because of the convenience.
It's convenient. Yeah. It's dense. It's the processed foods are calorically dense and delicious. They're easy to overconsume. So thinking about hormones again, we have hormones that signal cravings, signal happiness, and make us addicted to sugar. So there's actually food scientists. It's their whole job. They sit in a lab and they taste foods and they think about how to make us all crave and want these foods more. There's actually a ratio of fat, salt, and sugar that they add to these foods to make them craveable. So when you think about Pringles, you eat one, you don't eat one, right?
You eat the whole thing.
Once you pop, the fun don't stop. Yeah. Now we've all eaten all the Pringles, right? Yeah. And even if you weren't hungry, maybe you were craving it or maybe you had one and you couldn't stop. But when's the last time you overate hard-boiled eggs and ate a whole dozen by accident?
Oh, never.
Right.
I'm like good at like two hard-boiled eggs and I'm like, okay, eggs another day.
And it's a whole real unprocessed food, right? If you ate three of those for breakfast, you'd probably be full till lunch.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But if you start your day with a donut, you're crashing 2 hours later wondering what to eat and the amount of calories in the donut was way more than the eggs. So that's where it's kind of like not so much that everyone needs to jump into macro counting, but really take it back and are you eating real foods? Our bodies know what to do with real foods. We don't crave eggs for a reason, right?
Yeah.
Unless we're truly hungry. Like it will satisfy hunger. So going back to real foods, I think is important.
It's that sugar content. That's what we're craving.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Mm. So there's a lot of mixed information when it comes to dieting, you know, whether you want to lose weight or maintain your current weight. Is a low-carb, low-fat diet the way to go for women? Or is it a recipe for a hormone disaster? And I think that's what it's going to be.
Disaster. I don't know how you could do low-carb, low-fat. What are you eating?
But we're marketed like that is the answer. Yes. And it's not.
No, it's definitely not. And I think there's no one-size-fits-all approach. And I think, you know, the diet industry will attach themselves to these kind of, you know, headlines.
Yes, that's
you know,
how they get you.
The quick fix. And we're here to say, if there was a quick fix, we'd be millionaires.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, I always say that. If I had a magic wand, I, you know, I would tell you. I wouldn't keep it a secret. And the reality is going back to whole foods and, you know, really meeting the demands of what your body needs and not going too low on carbs and not going too low on fats or protein. You're going to end up being hungry. Mm-hmm. You're going to end up feeling tired and fatigue. And, you know, then there's this whole cycle of cravings, right? So we know the number one things that causes cravings usually is not eating enough or being undernourished because your body's signaling you to get nourishment. We feel that in salt or sugar, right? We don't feel it in eggs.
If only.
Right? Or chicken or fish, right? Uh-huh. We want, and partly because those signals will require our body to get quick food, right? Our body's kind of interesting in our homodynamic, our homeostasis, right? So if you're craving things, it knows, oh, I'm not nourished enough. If I crave sugar, those are calorie-dense foods and I will feel mm-hmm.
quick
satisfied.
Energy. That food energy is energy, right?
Right away.
Correct. Yeah.
Your body wants quick energy.
Yeah. So we find that is the biggest kind of predictor of actually that yo-yo cycling, right? That yo-yo dieting.
That's exactly
where
what it is.
I've tried every diet and I failed every diet. Well, the diet industry failed you, right? Because
they really have.
Because it's not teaching you exactly what you need to know about your body and teaching you exactly how your body works and what your body needs.
Well, thank goodness for wonderful people like you that can teach us the right things that we need to know that are actually going to help us. And I think it starts with making those small daily choices that are better, healthier options.
And I think even when you said, what do you think of that diet? So diet to me implies short-term, quick fix, failure. Yeah. Like no one, even if you succeeded in the diet, when you stop, the weight comes back. So nobody has a really great diet success story, right? Uh-huh. It's the people who make a lifestyle change with the small, daily, healthy habits and slowly add them in and where they're feeling good, they're feeling better to keep eating a certain way that fuels their body.
All adds up.
Exactly.
Now, what about the 30-30-30 weight loss rule? So the idea of you get 30 grams of protein within 30 minutes of waking, and then you do 30 minutes of low intensity exercise. I'm a big YouTube person. I love to watch videos of different people. And a lot of people talk about this, the 30-30-30. Does it work? Or
never,
is it just too good to be true?
Never heard of it.
Really?
No. Okay. But what I would say is I agree with 30 grams of protein. That's what we've been talking about for breakfast, right? Break your fast with some protein. I don't think that has to be immediately within 30 minutes. I think 30 minutes of movement in the morning is great. Get your body going. But I don't think it has to be this 30-30-30 time frame or bust, right? I think movement's good.
It's a little
protein's
pressure.
Good. It feels a little like, okay, we're busy working professionals. What if I can't do it in 30-30, right? I think that's too much pressure. But yes, I think we've already talked about the 20 to 30 grams of protein to break your fast. That's great. And movement in the morning. I like to move in the morning. Otherwise, it won't happen. So yeah, I think that's great.
All right. Get that movement in the morning.
Yeah. And I think, you know, there is some benefit to some time-restricted eating for some patients for metabolic health. And I think to say you have to eat within 30 minutes of waking up is not always the adage rule that we have to follow. It's very individual based on, you know, your personal needs too.
Sure. It's different for every person, movement too.
Correct.
So I'm pretty sure I'm already doing this, the 3-hour diet. Can we talk about this?
Let's break it down.
What is positive? What is that?
That I eat like every 3 hours.
Oh, yeah.
So
tell me my biggest question for you. Uh-huh. What are you eating very first thing? What's your breakfast? What are you breaking the fast with?
Right now, I've been doing a lot of oatmeal.
Okay. Yeah. Just straight oatmeal with what?
Oatmeal and bananas.
Is it old-fashioned oats? Is it instant oats? Is it brown sugar cinnamon oatmeal?
It is not brown sugar. Because as I mentioned earlier, I'm doing a fast right now. Yes. So no sugar at all right now. But this is not typical.
So it's oats and a banana.
Yes, oats and a banana.
With milk.
I'll put maybe just a dash of like pea protein milk.
Mm-hmm. And that's all that's in it.
That's it. Yeah.
And then you're hungry 3 hours later or you're used to eating every 3 hours and you're looking forward to the snack.
Hmm.
you're ready to eat because you're used to eating a snack, or your stomach's growling and you're truly hungry, or it's just, oh, it's 11 o'clock. This is my snack time.
I think it's because I'm used to eating. There will be some hunger pangs, but it's not always there. Mm-hmm. And I think it's just a habit that I reach for that snack because I'm like, okay, it's snack time.
So, and that definitely happens. So our bodies get into cycles where we're used to it, right? So if every day my lunch breaks at noon, it's like, oh, it starts growling because that's lunch break. But maybe you had a bigger breakfast. Maybe you're not really hungry. So a few things. Number one, oatmeal is mostly carbs, but banana is all carbs. So you are not getting anywhere near 20 to 30 grams of protein in that. If it's old-fashioned oats, steel-cut oats, maybe you're getting 5 grams of protein depending on the serving. There's a little bit of fiber, zero protein, right? Really, really low. So you're not hitting, you're not turning that off. That doesn't mean, I love oatmeal. I'm not against oatmeal. But where, instead of the banana, could you throw some chia seeds in? Could you throw some nuts? Could you use milk? Could you add a scoop of protein powder if you wanted to? Could you find, could you add an egg on the side, right? They even make egg white oatmeal. Could you throw some egg whites in there?
Okay, I've not had eggs and oatmeal, but I don't know. That might be a bit of stretch.
Or maybe you cut your oatmeal in half and you have some Greek yogurt on the side. Maybe you have cottage cheese on it. But adding that protein, right? You can get it in any way, form. Adding that, that'll elongate and you won't need the snack. But there will be some hunger pain memory where maybe your body's like, oh, we usually have a snack right around now. The other thing to think about is boredom, right? Not saying that you're bored. I know you're a busy
I'm definitely not bored. I think it's just more so a habit. And I feel like I'm not the only one in this case. Yeah. You just, you know, you open the pantry and you're like, I think I should have a snack now to inspire me for my next project that I'm about to work on.
But I would say it's not necessarily boredom. I would think it's that you need a mental break.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I think sometimes you get the email, you're like, I can't touch that yet.
Yeah.
And I, you know, it's like that commercial break on the TV show. Like it just all of a sudden kind of stimulates. And so it's not like we're not using our brain energy and that we're bored and have nothing to do, right? I don't know many adults who have nothing to do. No,
there's always something to do.
Right.
So whenever I hear someone say they're bored, I'm like, have you looked around?
Yeah.
There's so much you could be doing.
So you could almost say it's time for a dopamine hit.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, I need more energy.
Mm.
And I think what Dr. Magdaleno is right. You know, the energy you're getting from your breakfast isn't hitting all of that. You're probably getting a surge of that energy and then you're plummeting.
Yeah.
Right? Because those natural carbs and sugars, you're feeling really good, maybe an hour, maybe even 90 minutes. And then you're starting to, without that protein, because that protein's the bridge.
Mm-hmm. And even healthy fats, throw a scoop of nut butter, get rid of the banana, throw some nut butter in there, right? So that's that having everything, having protein, fat, fiber, and a little bit of carb, whereas that's all carb.
3-hour diet, not a good idea, right?
Correct.
Okay.
No.
Are there ways to avoid the afternoon slump? So I love a good cup of coffee in the morning. I froth the milk, add a little maple syrup. Ooh. And sometimes it's so good. It's like next level. Yeah. And I also think in a sense it's kind of healthier than like just like cane sugar. At least that's what I tell myself. I don't know. Is it actually healthier?
I don't know if she wants us to comment on that.
Like, it's
okay.
Processed.
She enjoys
Maybe
her
don't
coffee.
Break my heart.
It is less processed.
Let her have it.
We'll move on.
Okay. All right. So I can still have it.
Cool. Let her have it.
I'll keep the maple syrup. Sweet. And sometimes I do find myself reaching for that second cup in the afternoon. Obviously, I'm typically at work, so I can't make my beautiful coffee that I do in the morning. But when I do that, I do kind of regret it because around midnight, I'm like wired and ready to clean the house and I need to be asleep. So what are some good energy boosting snacks that, you know, outrule the second cup of coffee?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's what exactly we've been saying is getting whole foods, getting, you know, energy from protein, you know, at getting a little bit of a healthy carb with that. You know, you were saying that you'd like a snack of apple and peanut butter. An afternoon snack of that can give you a little bit of the sugar, a little bit of the healthy fats, and a little bit of protein. All three. You hit three boxes in that. And that can kind of give you that little bit of lift that you're looking for with a little bit of sweetness. And I think people like their coffee because it has a little bit of a flavor. And it has a sweetness and it hits that note a little
bit. A little sweet tooth in the morning.
Yeah, without the effects of the caffeine.
Yeah.
The other thing too is, you know, why are you having that slump, right? Is it from stress? Is it because you didn't sleep enough the night before?
Ooh, I think it's both stress and not sleeping. And lately I have been waking up every night around 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning and I'm like wide awake. And that's even sometimes without having that second cup of coffee. So I don't know, something's a little off. Maybe it is stress.
Yeah.
Maybe not getting enough of the right foods possibly.
So I do recommend to my patients, you know, everyone needs good quality and good quantity sleep. So you want 7 to 8 hours of sleep. Sure. That's the quantity. And then quality is like sleeping through the night, getting enough deep sleep, light sleep, REM sleep. And so having a wind down routine, having a dark, cold, quiet room, right? Don't let the dog sleep in your bed. Keep the kids out if you can, right? I'm doing my best there.
I have the dark, quiet room. I have the air purifier and all of that. But I still have a tendency to wake up. And I'm sure you're not the only person.
No, absolutely. So I think patients come to me all the time. I'm tired. And I think that, you know, doctors jump into, let's check blood work. What could it be? Why do you have low energy? But my first question is, how are you sleeping? And they're like, terrible. And I'm like, that's why you're tired. So how do we go back to fixing our sleep? Mm-hmm. Sleep is critical. Like if being a newer mom, right? I have a 4-year-old and that's a 16-month-old. I very much know the newborn days, right? They're both pretty, knock on wood, they're pretty good sleepers right now. They do wake me up at least once a week. And you know, we've all been there. But when I wasn't getting enough sleep, I was a totally different person, right? Stressed, more emotional, more grumpy, more hangry. I craved sugar more. I craved coffee more.
All those things.
And that's, sleep is critical, right? When your body's really well rested and you truly are getting enough sleep, you're a totally different person. So I do recommend looking at your sleep, trying to figure it out. They have sleep medicine doctors. There's sleep studies. There's, you know, seeing your family doctor to talk about different things, doing a wind down routine. Maybe melatonin's right for you. So it's different for everyone. Everyone has their different reasons of why they're having trouble. But when someone says, I have an afternoon slump, the first thought is, like Cheryl was saying, was your lunch appropriate enough? Mm-hmm. Are you eating those 3 meals? Are you fueling your body right? And then the second question is, are you stressed? Are you not sleeping well? And then water. Did you drink enough water? Our cells run on water too.
So how often do we forget to drink water? You know, even though we have these big 40-ounce jugs of water that we carry around the office.
So if you're not drinking enough, then you're also going to be tired.
Also exercise. I think when I feel a slump, I like to get up and move. I think we need to fuel, but I think, you know, we know that lack of movement makes you feel more tired than actual movement. And you sleep better when you actually have burned, you know, some energy throughout the day. And so thinking about that time, it's not always necessarily nutrition related. What if it's like, I've been just stuck in this chair for 8 hours.
Sitting in a desk all day.
I need to break out.
Even just going outside on your lunch break, it doesn't have to be 30 minutes, but just seeing the sunshine can improve your mood and your overall health.
Yeah, that circadian rhythm.
Absolutely.
So important. So speaking of sleep, you know, this is a debate that my husband and I continue to have. Is it better to go to bed a bit hungry or have a bedtime snack? I'm the one who's like, yes, I have to have a snack. Like, we'll eat dinner and I'm still hungry again. Like, and I usually
do that 3-hour girly.
I am that 3-hour girly. That's exactly who I am. Where are my 3-hour girlies?
Neither. You shouldn't be hungry, but you shouldn't eat within 2 to 3 hours of bedtime.
Oh, man.
Sorry.
So we do ballroom dancing. And it's a lot of fun. And where I'm going with this is sometimes after class, like I'm obviously famished. And that kind of goes back to my roots of growing up and doing dance and coming home and I would eat lots of food and then I'd just go burn it off the next day. Not the same anymore. So sometimes dinner doesn't happen until like 8 o'clock for us when we get back from class. And I try to go to bed by 10. So it's kind of a double-edged sword there working through that.
It's definitely tricky. And if that's once a week, it's once a week, right? You got to live your life.
Just once a week.
You got to enjoy your dancing. You got to live your life. But but all the studies and research really show that if you eat before bed or overnight, you are more insulin resistant later in the day.
Okay.
And when your body's focusing on digestion, it affects your heart rate while you're sleeping. It affects the stages of your sleep. So you actually have a worse quality of sleep if you're eating late at night, before bed, or overnight. So I really recommend eating with the sun, right? It doesn't have to, we don't have to call it fasting. We don't have to feel restricted. But the goal would be that we eat when the sun's up and we stop eating when the sun's down. That's a very normal.
And of course,
some people are night workers. You know, everybody's different. But I think for the average person, that would be the goal.
I gotta strive for that because I'm not quite there.
I mean, and I'm not there either, right? I'm not always there either. You get the kids to bed, you want that piece of chocolate.
Yes,
I'm there too.
Or a nice glass of milk with like a chocolate.
I thought you were gonna say wine, but milk.
Like, I mean, hey, wine's good too. I'm really into milk right now and like a brownie. It's just, there's something about the chocolate and then the creaminess of the milk. Oh, it's just so good. Oh.
It's also important to eat that kind of sweet beneficial right after a meal and not wait that obligatory 1-2 hours for your metabolic health. Yeah. That if you have something sweet, but it's piggybacked right after a meal, when you've had that protein, carbs, and fats, it doesn't get the same rise as it would in your, you know, into your blood, that sugar, and it can actually be beneficial.
Oh.
So eating your sweets right with your meal. Don't wait. Don't be like, I'll have dessert 2 hours later.
Okay, good. Then I can go home and I can tell my husband, hey, we got to get right to dessert. No waiting for that chocolate cake.
If you're going to have it, that's the best way to have it.
Oh, I love that. So which is healthier, plant-based milk or cow's milk?
So I think it depends on the person. Okay. I think they're all healthy and they all have their benefits.
Sure.
Cow's milk has the most protein naturally than any of the alternative milks. You can get an almond milk that has extra protein added. So if you're not interested in consuming dairy or if dairy doesn't, you know, agree with you, then an almond milk is absolutely fine. Soy as well. They have a little bit less protein than the cow's milk, but are a little bit better than the almond. Oat milk that comes from an actual carb is probably my least recommended.
And it doesn't have like much protein at all. That's why I'm kind of into the oat milk.
Doesn't have a lot. So if you're doing an alternative milk, I always say look for the ones that have added protein in it. So they've processed them in a way that has extra protein added, and that could be beneficial.
Okay. Is milk actually good for you, or should you focus on eating other calcium-rich foods instead of beverages?
So cheese, is made from milk, drinking whole milk, yogurts. That's where we're in our American diet. That's where we get most of our calcium from. Now, yes, you can get it from some other plants that have a little bit, but I would say dairy right now is from a whole foods approach where you would get it the most.
All right. Now, another hot topic is seed oils. There's a lot of claims online that they're inflammatory, cause weight gain, even for infertility. Is any of this actually true?
So, yes and no.
Okay.
So, seed oils inherently have omega fatty acids. And what the research has shown is that if you have an unequal balance of omega-6s versus omega-3s, that some of the omega-6s can produce a little bit of inflammatory effect on the body. But that is seen in research and very high levels and not necessarily in day-to-day life. What we see is that seed oils are cheap and they are put in a lot of processed food.
Mm-hmm.
So these studies aren't shown by itself that seed oils are bad, but that inherently what they're in is also packaged with a lot of processed ingredients that are very low on that nutritional profile that probably are more likely to create inflammation in the body in general.
Okay. So probably olive oil, avocado oil, those are the best ones to bake or
cook
with.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I think the most of us are using normal, you know, olive oils and extra virgin olive oils and, the safflower oils that you'd see in a potato chip is not something that most people are gravitating towards on the market, right? To cook your chicken in. And that's what they're looking at. So, you know, that safflower oil is part of, you know, the seed family.
Get rid of that canola oil. I can still see, especially I think in college, that was often what people would go for just because it was so inexpensive.
Yeah. And I mean, it's not that it doesn't have the best profile, but I think it's important to consume, like I said, the rainbows of fats, right? So, you know, who's just eating omega-6s and not getting the omega-3s, right? Mm-hmm. You want to get all of that so that they kind of connect together and create the fatty acid distribution that your body needs.
Yeah. So do both of you like to bake?
I love to.
She's more of the bake.
Okay. All right. What's your favorite thing to bake?
Oh, gosh. Put me on the spot. I make everything.
She makes a lot of great things.
Well, we're talking about the best oils to cook or bake with.
What's the best treat? So it depends if you're asking like my healthy self or my like super fun self, because I do both for the office and for my family.
Listeners both.
So I love, you know, if I'm making like my protein brownies or like my healthified banana bread with almond flour, I use olive oil in those. I do. That's extra virgin olive oil. It's good for you. It's Mediterranean diet. Oh, and I have a good one.
Yes. Okay. You'll have to share it with me because my husband, he loves to bake. I can't say I'm much of a baker, but when he bakes banana bread, the whole house smells so good. And it just, I just love it.
It's so good.
It's so delicious. Yeah. Which brings me to probably one of my biggest cravings is that sugar craving. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, what are the most common cravings among women?
Sugar. For everyone.
Sugar?
Yeah.
Sugar and salt.
Sugar and salt. Yeah.
Sugar. Mm-hmm.
And it goes back to that the hormones, right? Mm-hmm. So the the cravings in our brain.
Sure.
We get memories around certain foods, you know, oh, my mom used to cook this.
It's nostalgic. A memory.
Yeah. And so you get this craving for the memory, but there's also the craving for the sugar. Sugar's a dopamine hit. You know, it really is. Sugar's addictive. We are all addicted to sugar to different degrees, but yeah, we all get that same dopamine and serotonin and then that surge where we crave it.
Is it possible that these cravings are maybe a sign of like an underlying deficiency in something? Like, because I know like for some of us, like when we have our period, you know, we really want that chocolate. Is it because we're low in magnesium at that time?
So to an extreme, there are some cravings to an extreme where it may be something. But I would say the average American having cravings, it's really just that craving for that dopamine hit, whether it's, you know, stress, emotional, whatever. You just kind of, oh, I remember this. It'll feel good. Maybe you didn't feel right that day. Maybe you're thirsty. But there are some very extreme, you know, craving ice, craving, eating weird foods that it could be iron deficiency. But I would say the average person having a craving, no, you just kind of, you're just craving the chocolate.
Okay. Yeah. Do you have any tips for kind of curbing those cravings?
Yeah. I mean, I think first starting off with making sure you're well nourished and getting enough protein and making sure that these cravings are happening not because you're actually physically hungry. Mm-hmm. I think I always like peanut butter. I think it's a gateway to a little bit of sweet, a little bit of salt, a little bit of, you know, protein and healthy fats, and combining that with a whole food like a vegetable or fruit is a nice balance if we're talking about whole foods. Mm-hmm. I agree with Dr. Magdaleno, protein bars aren't really sustainable.
No.
They're, you know, they look like they're chocolate and they taste like they're chocolate for a minute, but then
they're really deceiving, especially with that packaging.
Yeah, but they're really not sustainable. Now, if that works for somebody, great. If it's a convenience thing and you have to take your kids to all the practices that I have to take my kids to, and you're in the car and you're driving and you got to get something and you can't do it, then it's a definite opportunity, you know what I mean, to get something in.
Sure.
But I think there's, you know, there's a ton of opportunity to kind of think about what you're actually craving and why. And, you know, how often does this occur? You know, that's what I look at. I mean, if it's a daily craving, well, then maybe I'm not eating properly every day.
Yeah.
If it happens, like you said, menstrual cycle wise, when we know those hormones are changing and we know we're more susceptible, and that's the fact, right? Yeah, there's a fact, right? So would I have a little bit of chocolate during that, you know, because it hits that kind of, you know, that hits that mark? Then potentially, but that's not, you know, every single day, every single, you know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon I'm having a bar, you know?
And also balancing, right? Did you drink enough water, right? Sometimes our cravings are just thirst. Did you get enough sleep? How are you feeling stress emotionally? And then also, you know, 80% of the time striving for protein, fiber, real foods, 20% having fun, right? Do we eat processed foods? Yeah. Yes. Do we go out to eat? Yeah. Do we have wine and chocolate? Sure. Mm-hmm. Like, it's life.
Yeah.
And what's life without those
joy,
things?
You know? Absolutely. Foods enjoyed when friends, foods, drinks.
Absolutely. And something too I talk to my patients about sometimes is, you know, having a craving, not letting the craving win or feel guilty about it, right? Kind of taking control and like, okay, I want chocolate. So I'm going to choose to have this chocolate. You're making the decision. And if you decide to, no guilt around it, but also portion controlling it, right?
Yeah.
So what's one little Dove chocolate going to do? It's fine. One little Dove chocolate.
Yeah,
after your meal, you controlled it, right?
Yeah.
A whole bar, 4 bars of chocolate. All right. Maybe that's a problem, right? So it's more about like really portion controlling it too. And treats can be definitely included in a healthy life.
Good.
Good.
All good things. We like our treats around here. Yeah. Now, you mentioned, Cheryl, something about physical hunger. What? How can you tell the difference between that physical hunger and that emotional hunger? Because I find like when I'm stressed or when I just want to, you know, avoid something, I go for the food.
Yeah.
But I don't know. When is it emotional? When is it physical?
Yeah, I mean, physical hunger, it should be felt, right? There should be an emptiness or a hollowness in the stomach. You could feel headache. You could feel a fatigue. You will physically feel that you don't have a craving. So if you're physically hungry, you would eat anything. You're not going, oh, I'm going to the pantry and I'm like, well, I don't feel like that. I don't really feel like that. Go back to the fridge.
It's that selective choice.
Yes.
Searching out for
That's a mental. I call that like acting like a shark in your own kitchen, right? You're like, you're looking for prey. Like, what am
I
getting?
That is me to
a T.
What
am I getting? And anytime I find myself doing that or my family, it's like, what are you looking for? Uh-huh. You're not hungry. Because if you're hungry, you come home, you're like, cheese, nuts, seeds. What am I? You'll not, you know, care what you're eating, right? You're really hungry and you need to get that food
just
in.
Just need to get it in my belly.
Or think about a certain food. Like, would I eat eggs and broccoli right now?
Yes.
No, those don't sound good. Chocolate sounds good. That's a craving.
That's a craving.
Yeah, that's a head hunger.
So earlier we talked about that hanger. And I am 100% guilty of being that hangry person, that hangry wife, that hangry colleague. What is the scoop with hanger? Why do we, how does it, you know, does hunger really impact our mood?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, when you don't feel satisfied or you feel physically hungry, yeah. you a lot of times can experience lower blood sugar, right? That's giving your body the sensation that you need to eat. And mood and food are so interconnected that, you know, whether people say it hangry or uh-huh. it's just that I'm tired.
Yeah.
I mean, you see it in children. Mm-hmm. What happens when they start to react
yeah.
negatively to certain situations? You're uh-huh. like, oh, I think it's time for something to eat.
Yes.
Right? So we know that even from an innate stage that this is occurring. So how to prevent it is, you know, making sure you're not yeah. waiting too long to mm-hmm. eat, right? And understanding that, you know, how long does that meal get you, and having snacks on board so that you're not grabbing a convenience food
sure.
just to kind of, you know, hit the spot.
So the way is to get enough protein at each meal, enough fiber that okay. you'll make it to the next meal rather than the every 3 hours constant snacks. So the hanger is what you're feeling is kind of the blood sugar change.
So
let's drop. So let's say you're having oatmeal and a banana. So your blood sugar in your body went up from, let's say, 80 to 130. And now it's coming back down. Uh-huh. It's coming back down quick because there was no protein. There was no healthy fat. So you're dropping. You're not having a low blood sugar. Mm-mm. You're feeling the change in blood sugar. Mm-hmm. You're feeling the drop from high as it's coming down. Mm-hmm. And your body's saying, oh, I'm running out of that quick sugar. What are we going to do? Oh, yeah. I'm feeling a little moody. I'm feeling a little mm-hmm. jittery, feeling a little nervous.
Uh-huh.
Grab a snack. That's what your body's saying.
Yeah.
If instead you rounded out that oatmeal banana with some protein and some healthy fats, you don't get the blood sugar spike, and your mood mm-hmm. and your blood sugar, who go hand in hand, stays mm-hmm. steady.
Yes. And everything stays
and
happy.
And you have this long energy. Protein and healthy fat give you the long game energy. Mm-hmm. Carbs are the quick energy, mm-hmm. the quick fuel. Carbs are quick.
So that's probably why too, that after I eat dinner, you know, if I'm lacking something in that meal, I'm hungry 30 minutes to an hour later. And this is something that happens fairly regularly. So yeah. I probably didn't have enough protein or enough carbs, the correct balance. And mm-hmm. again, it's veggies and protein first, right?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And volume, right? So yeah. those yes. veggies are like, wow. Yeah. So I have a salad. I have half my plate of broccoli. Then I have my protein and then some complex carbs. So it's all the volume too.
Well, we have learned so much today. It has been absolutely wonderful having you both here. Thank you so much. To wrap things up, what would you say is your best advice for making nutrition a priority and still work for your lifestyle?
Definitely having a plan. So as we've said, we're very busy working moms, yes. right? We have a lot going on. I always have a plan. It does not mean that I'm spending my entire Sunday meal planning, right? Because I have two young kids. I don't yeah. get time for meal planning either.
Doesn't happen.
But I do always have a plan. So okay. I have a routine. I have my go-tos. I have things that I know work,
all right.
things that I know ways to get the veggies in, right? So having a general plan for the week. I eat the same breakfast and lunch
yeah.
every day, and I have it planned. And then dinner, I have two or three to go, and I use my leftovers. And having that plan for the week is how you set yourself up for success. That's what I would say.
I would absolutely agree with that. I think we you know, walk the walk, right?
Yeah.
And you know, knowing what you're going to have, being prepared for the day is important. Having options for the day, I think, you know, we can attest that we don't always get time
yeah.
to eat, even lunches, right? Mm-hmm. Sometimes we get very busy, very backed up. And so, you know, saying, okay, I have this that I can eat very quickly versus this that's a little bit easier to eat versus this that I have to heat up. So, you know, we can't say that I'm just not going to eat lunch.
Right.
Because we know that fuel is so important for us. So that sure. is like having some quick options in there.
Yeah, so it all goes back to that balance and still having flexibility to adapt throughout the day, because there are so many things that come our way. Like
yeah.
how many times do we, you know, get interrupted with lunch, and sometimes it just doesn't happen.
Right.
You eat half of the pepper, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
And
you never yeah. get back to the other half.
Exactly. And that's where, you know, convenience products like protein bars yeah. and things like yeah. that do come into play. You know, we do mm-hmm. use them, but I do try to eat the whole real foods when I can. And when
sure.
I can, I have a backup for sure. Right.
Love it. Yeah. Excellent advice. Thank you both so much. Cheryl, Dr. Magdaleno, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for having us.
To learn more health tips, visit lvhn.org/healthy-you. Remember to subscribe or follow The Healthiest You wherever you get your podcast so you never miss an episode. And remember, be safe, be smart, and be the healthiest you.